is that copy the same as the original which you gave to the FBI?
I would say no. There is some films maybe missing, some frames. Some of the frames were ruined.
Did you think at that time that the shots came from the book depository building?
No, I thought it came from a fence between the book depository and the railroad track.
Did anyone else who you know or who you've spoken with also believe that the shots came from there?
Most everyone thought it came from the fence.
Imaginez que je sois le président Kennedy et que devant moi, il y ait le gouverneur du Texas, John Connally. Kennedy et Connally avaient sensiblement la même taille, mais avec la perspective, Kennedy était un peu plus en hauteur. Voici de quoi mettre les choses en perspective. La limousine présidentielle suit cette trajectoire. Selon la version Warren, Oswald se situe au sixième étage du dépôt de livres du Texas. C'est la version américaine, le sixième étage, hein, puisque si nous observions les étages du point de vue français, comme en France il y a un rez-de-chaussée, ça serait pour nous le cinquième étage. Donc, si la limousine va dans cette direction, Oswald est en hauteur à l'arrière droit de la limousine présidentielle. Si un tir est effectué d'un tel endroit, vous voyez bien la perspective, voici à peu près ce que ferait la balle. Elle toucherait le dos de Kennedy pour ressortir par le cou. Mais pour ensuite taper le gouverneur Connally à l'arrière dans l'omoplate droit et de ressortir par une trajectoire descendante après avoir perforé le poumon pour aller se ficher dans le poignet, le fracturer, puis de faire une trajectoire avec un virage qui l'a fait aller se ficher dans le fémur gauche, si vous voulez, il faudrait que la balle ait amorcé deux virages. Refait d'une autre manière. La balle qui vient de derrière tape Kennedy dans le dos. Elle ressort par le cou, puis elle va se ficher dans l'omoplate droit de Connelly. Elle ressort après avoir perforé le poumon et dans une trajectoire descendante, Connelly, qui a son poignet comme ça, voit son poignet droit fracturé. La balle ricoche ensuite vers le fémur gauche de Connelly. On voit bien que la balle magique, qui est une des trois balles avancées par la commission Warren et notamment un des membres. Pas des membres directs, mais un des types qui travaille pour la commission Warren s'appelle Harlan Specter. C'est lui qui avance cette théorie de la balle magique. On voit bien que c'est une balle zigzag qui est obligée de faire deux virages et qu'on rend responsable, si vous voulez, c'est bien commode, hein, des six blessures occasionnées, outre les tirs à la tête, au président Kennedy et au gouverneur du Texas, Connally. Hein. Première blessure dans le dos de Kennedy. Deuxième au cou. Troisième dans le dos de Connelly, donc l'omoplate droit. Quatrième, il ressort par devant après avoir perforé le poumon droit. Cinquième, la fracturation du poignet de Connelly. Et sixième, le fémur gauche éraflé. Donc, vous voyez bien que quand on travaille sur la balistique et sur la trajectoire des balles, impossible qu'une balle qui vient de cette direction à l'arrière de la limousine et qui taperait le dos de Kennedy, fasse ensuite, après être ressorti par le cou, un zigzag pour aller taper le gouverneur Connally dans le dos, ressortir par le devant après avoir perforé le poumon, puis après, ensuite aller, la balle va fracturer le poignet droit de Connally et la balle va ensuite faire encore un virage pour aller taper le fémur gauche de Connally. On voit bien que c'est une balle fourre-tout qui a été avancée par la commission Warren pour expliquer toutes les blessures et maquiller évidemment le nombre réel de tirs. Hein, parce que c'est ça qui est gênant. Et on voit bien l'implication de Lyndon Ben Johnson, qui est la personne qui a mis en place cette commission Warren pour empêcher, si vous voulez, toute enquête plausible.
Okay, here's a list. Do you want to go over that list to see if any of them ring a bell to you?
Well, let's see. I've already named Clint, Hunt, Lyndon came in, McCloy, Nixon, J. Edgar Hoover, I have said, Bill Decker, the sheriff of it's Dallas County, Cliff Carter, and Malcolm Wallace. Malcolm E. Wallace. Of course, George Brown, Earl Cabell, the mayor.
Earl Cabell. Who was Earl Cabell?
Earl Cabell? Cabell was an old Dallas family. And his brother was Pierre Charles Cabell. And he was in the CIA, deputy director, I think it was. And Lyndon, Lyndon, John Kennedy fired him over that Cuba, the Bay of Pigs. And Alan W. Dulles, too, I think was involved in that. So they fired Cabell, and that was a real raw spot with Earl Cabell, who at that time was mayor of Dallas and later went on to be congressman. But there was some real bad blood there.
A seamstress and companion, May Newman, provides confirmation that this party took place at the Murchison family home on the eve of the assassination. She lived and worked in another Murchison house in Dallas for Virginia, Clint Sr.'s second wife. She speaks here for the first time.
I started working for Virginia Murchison in 1962 until her death in 1997, approximately 36 years. I remember well the night before the assassination. I worked with a man called Jewel Pfeiffer, black man, which was Virginia Murchison's chauffeur. He got a call from her stepson, John, at the big house. They were having a big party for a very special guest that was coming from Washington to go to the party by the name of Bulldog, which I found out later was J. Edgar Hoover.
the assassination had not happened that day, Lyndon Johnson would have been in heat, bad power problems. When he got to Washington, you know what? Of course, we didn't have the communications right in those days. The first thing that Lyndon did, he went to find out what the House and Ways Committee, what they did that day. Mm. That was his first step. Mm. He was concerned.
So he knew that they were fixing to indict him.
Oh, sure.
And
that's what happened to Jenkins, the fellow that had worked so faithfully with him.
Yeah.
He was going to testify against Lyndon. So what they do, they set him up as a homosexual and they destroyed him. Henry Marshall.
Henry Marshall.
Yeah, Henry. Yeah, I knew Henry. he was going to testify too. And they said he killed himself, but I've never understood how he could take a .22 and shoot 5 bullets into his stomach.
A bolt action .22
yeah,
rifle.
His bolt action. Yeah, I knew Henry. Well, they found him dead on the ranch.
Yeah.
But he was agricultural. Right. There were 3 or 4 of those guys that were involved in it.
The word is that he was going to testify about the kickbacks to Johnson from the agriculture program.
Mm-hmm.
On peut rajouter que ça tenait tellement pas la route que un des membres de la commission Warren, qui est Gerald Ford, qui deviendra un futur président américain, a admis qu'il avait été obligé de changer la description des blessures au cou de Kennedy pour faire concorder, si vous voulez, l'entrée du dos avec la sortie au cou, si vous voulez. Car si à l'autopsie on a trafiqué, si vous voulez, en agrandissant le trou pour modifier l'emplacement, c'était déjà pour essayer de faire coïncider le point d'entrée du dos avec un éventuel point de sortie au cou, si vous voulez. Mais en plus, au niveau des rapports sur lesquels Gerald Ford a mis la main, ça a été déplacé pour qu'il y ait un semblant de logique, si vous voulez, dans la trajectoire de la balle. Voilà.
The Warren Commission's lone gunman theory relies on something called the magic bullet. One bullet would have caused all the non-fatal wounds to JFK and Texas Governor John Connally sitting in front of him. Warren Commission staffer Arlen Specter came up with that one. What do you know? He wound up a sinner. Gerald Ford later admitted that he changed the description of JFK's wounds to make the theory sound more plausible. He wound up president. You helped the Warren Commission in the cover-up? Good things can happen.
A political crisis gathered over America. After a deluded gunman assassinated President Kennedy, our nation turned to Gerald Ford and a select handful of others to make sense of that madness. And the conspiracy theorists can say what they will, but The Warren Commission report will always have the final definitive say on this tragic matter. Why? Because Gerry Ford put his name on it, and Gerry Ford's word was always good.
Là, de toute façon, ça, c'était la commission Warren, la balle magique qu'on vient très facilement de d'écarter, si vous voulez. Mais là, dans la suite de la vidéo, vous allez voir les impacts photographiés qui montrent qu'il y a eu bien plus que trois tirs qui ont été effectués ce jour-là.
There was a deputy sheriff, which I think was stationed under the underpass, Buddy Walters. At this time, I says, you know, I felt something sting me on the face as I was standing down there. I said, just sting, and Walters looked at me and says, yes, says, you got blood on your cheek. He says, where were you standing? I says, well, down by the underpass, so we started walking down there. And when Walters got about, oh, I'd say 10 feet away, he says, look there on the curb, there was a very visible mark on the curb where a bullet had struck. Either a fragment of the bullet or a piece of the concrete, it flew up and scratched my face. And he said, go to the city police headquarters and make a statement, which I did.
When the shots were being fired, your first impression was that they came from the area near the wooden fence.
That's correct.
All right, next up, we're going to shoot some bulletproof glass. Glass already has one shot in it, just so you can really see exactly, you know, what happens if you have multiple impacts, multiple fire, and our glass will stop multiple rounds. See, the back's completely smooth, no penetration whatsoever, and let's put a new shot in it today and see how it performs. So this is one that's already been shot up on. We want to do a second shot to show. Okay, Bond is going to shoot for us here on the glass. Woo! There you go. A man in a nice suit shooting an AK-47. I love it. Let's see what you did, Bond. Yeah, go ahead. Pull it back. Pull it back. Yeah, back.
That one.
You gotta pull hard. Pull it out.
All the way. Pull it out.
There you go.
Go ahead. That's
good
shot right there.
Good shot, Bond. Good
shot. Okay. That was a shot that I go to right now that you can see what happened here. Behind here, I shoot glass and feel as smooth as nothing happened, right? This is perfect. So this is what we're talking about here, right there.
Clear. That put a pretty good sized mark on that glass.
Oh yeah, it went right through it. Blew up the water. Messed it all up. Look at that. That's some of that fiery stuff, whatever that was. Went right through it. Hello! And it destroyed the whole water we had over here.
Un 45, este 38, que es un Smith & Wesson, 38 especial, recortado.
No, es 357.
357, perdón, recortado. Que estas son las armas normalmente comunes en República Dominicana. Este es un Springfield 9 milímetros. Estas son las armas que servirán para la prueba. Loren. Aquí, como pueden ver, podemos ver el comportamiento de este vidrio E4 con los diferentes tipos de armas y calibres.
El cristal en su totalidad no tuvo ningún tipo de deformación al interior, es decir, que tiene una muy buena protección. Como pueden ver, puedo pasar la mano, en el cual no tiene ningún tipo de penetración.
Where do you now think that the shots came from?
I believe that they did come from the school book depository because of the things I've read about, the evidence which has been brought forth in the newspapers and through the Warren Report and so on.
There was a flash of light, there was something which occurred which caught my eye in this immediate area on the embankment. At this time, I could not identify it other than there was some unusual occurrence, a flash of light or smoke or something, which caused me to feel like something out of the ordinary had occurred there.
In reading your testimony, Mr. Bowers, it appears that just as you were about to make that statement, you were interrupted in the middle of the sentence by the commission counsel, who then went into another area.
That's correct. I was there only to tell them what they asked, and so that when they seemed to want to cut off the conversation, I felt like that was, as far as I was concerned, that was the end of it.
Mr. Bowers, how many shots did you hear?
There were three shots, and these were spaced with one shot, then a pause, and then two shots in very close order, such as perhaps almost on top of each other, while there was some pause between the first and the second shots.
Did you tell that to the Dallas police?
Yes, I told this to the police, and then also told it to the FBI, and also I had a discussion two or three days later with them concerning this, and they made no comment other than the fact that when I stated I felt like the second and third shots could not have been fired from the same rifle, they reminded me that I wasn't an expert and I had to agree.
And they took him down to Dealey Plaza and they said, okay, Mr. Nix, where did the shots come from? Where did you hear the shots come from?
From a fence between the book depository and the railroad track.
Cut. Now, Mr. Nix, where did you hear the shots come from?
It came from a fence.
Cut. They finally pulled him aside, this man did, and pulled him aside and said, now, Mr. Nix, what did the Warren Commission say? Where did they say these shots came from?
From the book depository.
And they said, that's right, and that's what we want you to say. And I remember riding home with him. He was so upset. I mean, he would hit the driving wheel, the steering wheel, and say, why? I mean, they try and make me look like I'm insane. And I know that's where they came from.